dignitaries on the dais.
Yes, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm extremely grateful to the my colleagues and all the well-wishers and supporters and the dignitaries who have been supporting this scheme as part of the selection committee, and my colleagues who were working very hard to identify kids to qualify for the Udayer Pathe program. It's heartening to see the progress they have made. The healthcare industry is a very interesting industry, especially from the Indian context, because this industry can emerge as India's largest employment generator. The greatest threat for India is going to be the unemployed youth. If we are not able to give 300 to 400 million young people a meaningful job, a job which will give them sufficient remuneration and the respect, believe me, they will ruin this country. And very little is done so far to create those employment generating industries and the opportunity. I'll just give an example of how healthcare industry creates disproportionately higher number of jobs. The largest automobile manufacturing company of India, with a revenue of over 65,000 crore rupees per year, employs 13,500 people. We as a group, Narayana Health, we have about 30 odd hospitals, and we have a revenue of over 2,000, just about 2,000 crore rupees. And we hire 16,000 people. You look at the top line of automobile and the top line of healthcare, it is disproportionately higher. And more than the number of people who are given employment, this industry can give employment for millions and millions of women from rural India. It is an ideal industry for creating jobs for women from rural India. Why do we need to look at creating jobs for rural women and men? Mainly because even after 70 years of independence, we are still dependent on agriculture as the source of employment. Nearly half the country's jobs are dependent on agriculture. But agriculture is only about 17% of the GDP. It's a very small percentage of the GDP, but half the country's population depend on that agriculture as the industry which can give them the job. But agriculture is not a reliable industry. It is a necessity, but it's not a reliable industry because we have failed to have enough irrigation projects, planned agriculture. As a kid, I spent most of my life spending time in my great-grandfather's villages, because I loved villages. I used to watch a very interesting phenomenon, which most of you would have observed it, but wouldn't have really, it wouldn't have made an impression on you. Indian agriculture is dependent on rain. When there is no rain, there is no crop, there is no money. When there is too much of rain, again there is no crop and there is no money. When there is adequate rain, there is bumper crop, and what they have grown has no value. So whichever you look at, farmer will go bankrupt. It is a matter of time. Now, the only way you can protect him is not loan waiver or any of the things what we are trying to do. We have to pull young people from the villages, bring them to the city, give them a meaningful job. Now, what kind of a jobs they can be given? There are very interesting jobs in healthcare which can be offered to rural men and women. I'll give an example. In a place like Mangalore, where I come from, there are young ladies. They are employed in a job called 40-day ladies. You may not even know what these 40-day ladies are about. These are the ladies. Their only qualification is that they had a child of their own. So they know how to take care of the child. And obviously they were pregnant and they went through the childbirth. In a city like Bangalore, there are a large number of young software engineers who get married and they have their first child. And in good old days, mother-in-law or a mother or someone used to come and take care of the pregnant lady and the newborn baby. Today, that bond is lost. They are all by themselves. So when this young lady comes home with a little baby, she is lost. She doesn't know how to bathe the baby. She doesn't know how to take care of them herself. And more than anything else, it's a loneliness. She doesn't even have someone to talk to. So these ladies, their job is to help the pregnant lady who has just given birth to the baby and take care of the young mother and the baby for 40 days. That's why they are called 40-day ladies. And there are agencies in Mangalore which provide those ladies. Now, I want to ask you a question. For 40 days, how much money they earn? Can anybody take a guess? How much money they get paid for working, taking care of the pregnant lady and the baby just for 40 days? They get paid over 55,000 rupees. And this country, which gives rise to, which delivers 26 million babies, even if you assume 10% of them need these 40-day ladies, look at the jobs what are created. But we are not creating it because we are not creating an organized structure to employ them. If healthcare industry is well organized with the intention of being a largest employer, believe me, this country's healthcare problem, the financial problem, job distress can be addressed in no time. Because we can easily create 5 million jobs and earn over $100 billion of foreign currency every year. I'll give an example. Cuba sends 45,000 doctors, nurses, and medical technicians to Central America and earns close to $9 billion of foreign currency a year, which is nearly 30% of their foreign currency earning. And Philippines sends about 1.5 lakh doctors, nurses, and technicians to all over the world and earns $29-30 billion of foreign currency a year. And if we can liberate medical education, remove the shackles which is artificially keeping the shortage, and let medical education blossom, this industry can be the largest foreign currency earner for our country. All we need is a policy change. It doesn't require billions of dollars of foreign currency or an FDI to come and start manufacturing or any of the industries. Now, I'll just give a comparison. What a job for a nurse or a doctor outside India means. She's a girl who's must be in her 26, 27 year old. This girl, can you switch off the lights so that they can see me? Can you switch off the lights? So this girl joined our hospital many years ago as a A&M because her parents couldn't afford her to send her to the nursing college. So the government sponsors this training program somewhere from Kerala, she joined. Then she joined GNM because she couldn't afford when she was working, she completed the GNM, then did her BSc. And when we built our hospital in Cayman Islands, she was on the top of the list because she is one of the outstanding nurses. And 2 years after working in Cayman Island Hospital, she took her family members, the parents and in-laws, on a holiday to Niagara Falls. Tell me which professional in this country can afford to take their parents on a holiday to Niagara Falls at the age of 25, especially a girl coming from a poor socioeconomic background. And this is what this industry can do. So, essentially, we need to look at healthcare industry not as an industry which takes care of the pain and suffering, as an industry which can drive the economy of 21st century. People think oil and natural gas is a big industry. It's only a $2 trillion industry. People think automobile is a big industry. It's only a $2 trillion industry. Everyone thinks IT is a big industry. It's $3.4 trillion. You know how big healthcare industry is? $8.2 trillion. It is the largest industry in the world. And this industry can emerge as the largest employer. National Health Service of United Kingdom, which takes care of just 60 million people, hires 1.7 million people. That is the fifth largest employer in the world. If Indian healthcare blossoms, it can create millions and millions of jobs for all the rural youngsters, women and men. And for this to happen, we need policy changes. I would like to congratulate the government of West Bengal for starting the discussion to create more nursing colleges. 15 years ago, when the new government was selected in the state of Karnataka, the chief minister invited me for a discussion. He asked me, how many nursing colleges you need? And I told him that, sir, a state like this, we need 1,000 nursing colleges. And people thought I am crazy to even talk about the number. The government gave permission for 1,000 nursing colleges. And we have 1,000 nursing. Some of them may not be up to the mark, but good ones have survived, bad ones have closed. But essentially, we have created that many nursing colleges. So if West Bengal government decides to create 1,000 nursing colleges, you look at the number of people who can take their parents on a holiday to Disneyland. This is what education can do. Once again, I would like to congratulate all the young people who have become doctors today. And I hope at least some of them to become heart surgeons, so one day when I grow old, they can operate on my heart.